Greetings, everyone. How's everybody doing today? Yeah?
Yeah.
You look like the most unenthusiastic bunch of people that I've seen in a long time.
It's late on Friday.
Wait,
so.
I need a show of hands. How many of you are just sitting here because it's an open seat and it's late in the day?
Us too.
Yeah, us too.
Yeah, really.
Why are we sitting in the comfy seats and y'all get the crappy seats?
Yeah, sure, what? That works.
We're the what?
Speakers.
Are we really? You mean everybody doesn't have mics? This isn't just an open rap session?
Cool.
All right. How many of you are familiar with Angry Mac Bastards?
Oh, good.
Hey,
cool.
Right on. Hey, we have more than one listener.
Yeah, cool.
Who's willing to admit it in public?
We had this one guy in the bar the other night who was trying to convince us that he was the only guy who listened to our show.
Who would admit it in public?
Is he here?
No.
No.
At least
I think he killed himself. I'm not sure.
Let's see here.
Let's get the show on the road.
Can we get this party started?
I don't know. I hope that PC1 audio is going. I'm not sure. No, maybe not. I'm plugged in.
Make sure your volume is.
Do we need something for that that audio?
You want to make sure your volume is turned up, gentlemen. Volume up.
I could try it again.
Can you hear me? I guess you can't hear me.
Yeah. Should be working. It's the headphone jack. Oh, hold on.
Did you have it plugged into the?
Yeah.
The headphone jack.
Yeah, it's plugged into the right audio out.
It is.
Close enough. So, for those of you who can barely hear it, that is the awesome theme music.
That is our awesome theme music.
Indeed.
Welcome to Angry Mac Bastards. My name is Peter Cohen.
I'm John Welch.
And I'm Darby Lyons. Thank you.
Thank you. For those of us who don't know us, do any of us really know us? And by the way, that theme music was from Jim Dalrymple at The Loop, our close bosom pal. For those of you who don't know us, we have a weekly podcast called Angry Mac Bastards. You can find it on iTunes, angrymacbastards.com. And it is our job to rant about all the incredibly crappy and stupid analysis and insipid news that you read in the Apple ecosystem each and every week in the mainstream media and in the tech media.
Yeah, what he said.
Yeah. Basically, we go out and find tech pundits and then feed them through a wood chipper, essentially.
We read the crazy so you don't have to.
Yeah.
It's cheaper than therapy for us and more painful for you. So, basically, this week we're going to share with you some of the most incredible crap that we've seen on the interwebs this past week that just offended the hell out of all of us and I'm sure is going to offend the hell out of all of you. If you haven't already seen it. Now, when you listen to our podcast, please understand that we work blue. If you don't know what that means, it means that we swear a lot. We're going to tone it down for this audience, though, we promise. Dan Morin, stop looking at me so disapprovingly.
Just because we're living your fantasy, you don't get to mess with us.
So, to open this week's show, I would like to take to task every single PR release, every single press release that's come out for Macworld in the last 3 weeks from every clueless PR moron at this show and elsewhere who kept intercapping the damn W in Macworld. The most annoying thing that you could imagine.
Yeah, all you have to do is look around or you look on the website. It's like, come on, people, this has not been intercapped ever.
Yeah, 10 seconds of work. You can see how it's spelled. It's not hard.
Yeah. What's unbelievable to me is, you know, I tweet about this stuff and you talk about it elsewhere, and people start arguing the point with me. No, they used to intercap. They used to intercap. No, they didn't. I worked for the magazine for 10 damn years. I know.
Yeah.
They don't intercap the W now or ever. The only one who ever did was Macworld Sweden, which has a reader base of about 3, so who cares?
And they Ludafisk. God only knows how they actually spell anything.
It's true. I think they put a big slash through the O, too.
Make weird.
So if you're one of the many PR people who have made my life a living hell looking at your stupid press release for the past 2 or 3 weeks, come see me after the show.
Yeah. I mean, if
the beatings will be commencing in an hour.
Yeah. If you're gonna intercap the W, just capitalize everything and make it look like you're shouting.
So our second piece to comes to us tonight, courtesy of Slate.
Oh yeah. So hold on, I have to. We actually had to save all this stuff locally to PDF because the show.
Yeah. Can everybody turn off their MiFis?
Yes.
Turn off your MiFis. I can't read.
So, how did Steve Jobs get his liver?
By William Solitan.
Undoubtedly,
on Slate.
Undoubtedly ripped from the living body of a Foxconn worker.
Yeah. Yeah.
More than one. He has a whole supply. There's just they're waiting in the wings.
Yeah. Basically, William Solitan, whatever the heck his name is, he's accusing Jobs of gaming the transplant allocation system.
You know, sort of the way that some developers game the App Store. For, yeah. You know, to improve ratings of their apps.
Yeah. Complaining that, oh, he's got a private jet, and he was on multiple transplant lists, and it's all because he's a billionaire. And it goes through, it's just incredibly stupid and vaguely offensive until he gets to the last paragraph. I hear you, Steve. We're all pulling for you. It's your life and your family. But that liver wasn't yours. Somebody died to make it available, and other people who aren't billionaires may have died on waiting lists so you could have it.
That's the way major organ transplants work. People die, you get their livers. Until we can start growing them in vats someplace.
And Foxconn.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yeah, there's always Foxconn.
Yeah.
Thank God for 1.5 billion Chinese people.
Yeah.
So we can have cheap iPods and cheap organ transplants.
Exactly.
Absolutely. You know, I'm from a state where people are actually dying because of budget cuts and they can't get the transplants they need.
Oh, so, there's a special place in hell for Jan Brewer.
Yes, there is. This idiocy to complain because Steve Jobs has the money to work the system. You know what? That's the system. You want to change it, change the system. Don't bitch at Steve Jobs.
Yeah, and the implication that Steve Jobs killed someone because of his liver. Like, there's some poor, needy person who died, you know, in a ditch somewhere. Because the rich, evil man with his fancy plane and his fancy doctors and money got, you know, would you feel better if Jobs died? Would that, you know, and
I heard he bathes in the blood of Mac.
The bullcrap in this article, though, astounds me because there's stuff in here like, but now comes the report of the new report of Steve Jobs' illness, and with it, the unresolved question of whether he should have gotten that liver. We don't know what's ailing him. Let me stop right at that point, okay? We're conflating his liver transplant and whether or not he should have gotten it with, we don't actually know what the hell is wrong with Steve. For all we know, he's going to be down with mono for the next 6 weeks, and then he'll be back.
Yeah. Like, seriously. You know, what? Now he's ill again, so you should only get the liver transplant or an organ transplant if you know it's going to make you healthy forever. If it fixes you, if you're going to be sick again, why bother? You're just going to be sick again. They should go to someone who'll be well. And this guy got paid for this. Ah. Jesus.
Anyway, this is the sort of stuff that causes us to go into paroxysms of rage each and every week.
Yeah.
And we're just getting started.
Yeah.
So our next piece, John?
Our next piece. Oh, yeah, Android Central. So,
Android Central.
Anyone?
Who here has an Android phone? What the hell is wrong with you? Are you aware that you're a Macworld Expo?
You just don't admit it.
Who here has an Android phone and somehow thinks that Google actually cares about you and the carriers and the hardware manufacturers are keeping it open so you can do whatever you want and they're going to take extra special care of you because you're a pretty princess? Well, you are a pretty princess, ma'am, but I got news for you. Verizon don't care. So,
are you high right now?
Do you wish you were?
Seriously, I mean, the idea that Google is actually open is one of the greatest PR spins in the history of modern technology.
Yeah, and the best part is, though, is Android has become an endless source of Schadenfreude. You know, you read about this, oh, it's open, we can do whatever we want, it's going to be wonderful and perfect, and then you read how over and over the carriers and the hardware manufacturers...
Each and every week, new stories come out about how the carriers are screwing Android users over and over again. You can't upgrade to the latest OS.
Yeah, you got to get a new phone. Oh, we're not going to let you upgrade that phone, even though you bought it after the new OS came out. Oh, Google didn't like that app, so they pulled it off your phone. You know?
But they're open.
And yet, every time when you see these news and you look in the comments, all the Android users are like, well, no, but that's okay because they care about us.
So our piece that we're specifically referencing is from Android Central. Motorola employee confirms locked bootloaders and bad attitude.
Yeah. So one of the things, and Motorola, I think, is really taking the lead in this, is locking the phones so you can't root them and load new OS versions or firmware on them, or setting it up so as soon as you try, the next time you start the phone, it rolls it back to the way the phone was when you first pulled it out of the box. You know, the kind of things that an open, caring company does. And so someone got a little curious in, the comments of a YouTube video by Motorola and asked about that, and a Motorola employee replied, if you want to do custom ROMs, then buy elsewhere. We'll continue with our strategy that is working. Thanks. How open, how wonderful, how nice.
At least they're being honest about it. We're honestly closed.
Yeah. And of course, you go into the comments and it's all like, I don't believe Motorola is doing this. I'm going to HTC. I'm going to Samsung. Well, good luck with that. Oh, you think the carrier's going to be any better? I don't like all the crap that Verizon's putting on the phone. Well, buy a Verizon iPhone. Won't have it.
There you go. No crapper on a Verizon iPhone.
Yeah, wait until February 10th.
Yeah. But, you know, that's the Android community in a large extent. What they don't understand is Google is open to the carriers and the hardware manufacturers. If the carriers and the hardware manufacturers decide you can't add new software, but what they want you to, Google's fine with that. They don't care. They're not even making the phone.
So while I'm on the subject, just out of curiosity, who here is going to switch to a Verizon iPhone when it comes out?
Who here is going to do that because they have really just legitimately poor AT&T reception?
Well, no. Who here has legitimately poor AT&T reception? Okay.
Who here is surprised that the reception in San Francisco during the show has actually been as good as it has been? Yeah. Who here thinks that Verizon will somehow take much better care of you and care far more about you than AT&T does? Who here was ever a Verizon customer before who thinks that?
All right, stop abusing the audience, John.
I just
having to listen to us is abuse enough.
I don't get a chance to talk to anyone but you guys.
I know, seriously, this is the nice thing about actually having a live audience. We can actually ask you some questions and get some feedback. Let's get the wave going, guys.
Oh, it is easy to get people to do our bidding. We should start that cult.
So, yeah, you know, it's an interesting thing. I'll be really curious to see what the uptake is on the Verizon iPhone, specifically from people who are switching. You know, it seems like there was a lot of talk ahead of time about how, you know, upset people were with AT&T and how quickly they were going to change. But now that there is a Verizon iPhone, that's evaporating. I mean, not too many. I don't know if you folks actually looked around the room. Not too many of you raised your hands. You know, which tells me that, you know, maybe that sample size of people, you know, they talk a good game, but, you know.
Well, more importantly, now there's a choice. So you can make that informed choice, do what works for you, and you don't have to buy based on ideology or you know, cult behavior.
Yeah.
Buy the phone and the carrier that works for you.
One thing I will say about Android, though, is that they've got a really cute mascot.
That's true. That's true. I think Apple really does need a cute mascot for the iPhone.
My 10-year-old son really wants an Android plushie.
I imagine you can buy a plushie of almost anything in San Francisco.
I imagine you can get somebody to dress up like an Android plushie.
Who would follow you home and live in your basement?
Actually, this is San Francisco. I bet there's actually a convention of Android plushies that happens somewhere.
I wouldn't be, well, depending on what the crossover guy's schedule is, they might have an Android plushie.
That's right. Yeah, we got to check over at their booth afterwards.
Yeah. Okay, next thing up, first of all, before we start, is there anyone from iFixit here? Because if so, we want you in the front row. No? Oh, drat. So the next thing.
So who here is familiar with the word pentalobe? Okay.
Yeah.
Apple's diabolical plan to screw your iPhone.
Evil ascending. Translation. I don't know.
If you track down the iFixit guys, you can actually get one if you ask nicely.
Well, you know, credit for not using draconian, because
yeah.
I'm tired of posting that picture.
Actually, yeah. you know what? I have to say at the outset, guys, I am totally impressed with the way that iFixit handled this.
Yeah.
They managed to get a huge amount of press out of this.
Absolutely. You know, they point out it's an issue. There's no denying it. It's a weird screw. You got to get a special.
Well, hang on. We got to back up for those in the audience who don't know what we're talking about. As it turns out, Apple is actually replacing the screws in some cases anyway. This isn't universal because I just got the screen swapped out on my the back glass swapped out on my iPhone 4 and found that it wasn't the case. But if your iPhone 4 goes in for a repair for some reason. In many cases in Apple stores, they are removing the tiny 000 Phillips head screws, and they're replacing them with what are known as pentalobe screws. These are screws that have these incredibly tiny five lobes on them.
Lobes, yeah.
Pentalobe. And the screwdriver is a completely uncommon part. It's not something that you can go to Radio Shack or Sears and buy off the rack.
Yeah, it's vastly more rare than those idiotic Torx screws that Apple used to vex us with.
Yeah.
This is absolutely correct.
Yeah. So iFixit, of course, being iFixit, is terribly upset about this because it makes it harder for everyone to take apart their iPhones. Because, you know, everybody is taking apart their iPhones all the time, right? Oh, wait, no.
But, you know, to be fair to iFixit, at least they're proposing a solution. It's not just ranting and raving
on
the internet.
True.
They've got a product. It's $10. Here's this thing. You can replace the pentalobes with a normal Phillips screwdriver. Problem solved. Good. Everybody wins.
Yeah. It's things like a solution. Liberate your hardware.
Well, just the title, Apple's Diabolical Plan to Screw Your iPhone.
Yeah. In Evil Ascending. It's not that, they're wrong about it being a pain in the keister to deal with this screw. It's not that they're wrong that it kind of sucks and all this other stuff. It's like, okay, guys, seriously? Evil ascending? Liberate your hardware?
Admittedly, they're doing it for dramatic effect.
I still like the mental image of Steve Jobs looking at the design for a pentalobe screw going, I've got you now, I fix it.
It's true. But what's really kind of interesting about this is not iFixit's coverage so much, because, I mean, this is their stock and trade, right? This is ostensibly what they're there to do. It's how many other blogs, tech blogs around the internet picked up on the story and ran with it after the fact. And, of course, that's where we get the whole draconian Apple business kicking in again.
It's the echo chamber. I mean, nobody can report anything about Apple without it, the blogosphere spinning it into the worst, heinous, most heinous crime ever. It's just retarded.
Yeah. Well, who has ever played a game I like to call Trace the Source, and you take like a bunch of independent articles on some stupid controversy, and you start going back through all the links where they got it from, and you realize they all come from one source? Oh, you should sometime. It's funny because almost everything you read about that everybody's going, oh, it's evil. It's going to come back to the same article that probably has actually no factual content in it.
This is one of my big problems with tech blogs in general, and one of the biggest problems, I think, with the way that news has sort of, tech news anyway, has sort of evolved over the course of the past two or three years. now that everybody's got their own blog, now that everybody's trying to monetize the spread of information, and you know, Apple's a hot commodity. This is what we get. You know, what you end up with is, you know, this magnification and distortion. How many of you remember the movie Johnny Dangerously? There's this great scene in Johnny Dangerously where they start spreading information about a breakout down the prison grapevine. And by the time it starts out, it's a pretty clear message about, you know, when the breakout is going to occur and how it's going to occur. By the time it gets to the end, it's a completely distorted message. You know, Johnny hears it and can decipher it, but most people can't. Yeah. And this is what Welch is talking about when he talks about tracing the source. The stuff gets the message gets distorted, and you end up getting, you know, the diabolical Apple plan becomes something about draconian Apple, and Apple putting its, mm-hmm. you know, grubby little hands together, trying exactly. to figure out some way to completely take advantage of customers.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Moving on.
The next one is the Playboy thing.
Playboy on iPad renews debate over privacy workplace rules. Really? The backstory, the story from Computer World, Matt Hamblin?
Matt Hamblin, yeah. Matt Hamblin writes that every issue of Playboy is available on the iPad in a browser window beginning in March.
Yeah. Well, the first part of this story is actually what came before when Hugh Hefner, that you know, esteemed insider in the tech world, let it slip that the Playboy was coming to the iPad, which of course sent anybody into freaking paroxysms of, oh yeah, the draconian control is going away, that we're going to have our porn apps now finally, whatever. But you know, it turns out it's a web
page. Steve Jobs doesn't like porn, but you can put porn on the iPad pretty damn easily.
Right. And that's the problem with this
anybody
piece.
Want to see? I've got my iPad right over there. I can show you whatever you want.
Yeah, anyways.
Please? Yeah,
Peter's long.
Yeah. Anyways,
please.
Peter's lonely.
The problem with this story is that Matt Hamblin then takes it as now this is gonna be a problem for IT and enterprise, which will get John completely wound up. That all of a sudden, with this one product, this Playboy web page formatted for the iPad, we can't keep pouring off these personal devices that also have our company information. And yeah, like any other porn site that all of us have on our iPads. No, you can't stop the signal. It's where it is. You just deal with it. It's nothing new. This is just ginning up to, it's link bait. That's all it is.
Yeah, and the best part is at one point he's talking about like IT managers won't talk about what they have to go through to block porn. Well, probably not to you, but really, as an IT guy, we talk about it all the time. And our favorite answer is when you catch someone looking at porn at work, just fire them. Don't make us like install crap like Blue Coat and WebSense and all that other silliness that just encourages people to be more inventive with where they get their porn from. Because it's not a tech issue, it's a management issue. But this is nothing new. It's not like suddenly Playboy being available in a browser window like it has been for some time now, Playboy.com, is suddenly going to be some huge new problem for IT. It's like, hey, you, stop looking at porn. You know, I mean...
Yeah, imagine that, expecting your employees to act like adults.
Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah, the concern is centered around whether a coworker or a client might accidentally see something objectionable and file a complaint or drop a valuable account. Okay, so we're not actually talking about anything that's Apple related, although Apple is the center of the story here because Playboy is ostensibly available on the iPad. So what we're talking about is a generic story about IT having to manage, you know, pornography in the workplace. But, you know, because Apple headlines bait readers into clicking on them will make it tangentially about Apple.
Yeah. Yeah, it could be Playboy in Firefox renews debate over privacy and workplace rules. Playboy in Chrome.
Yeah, but there's no link bait to be had there.
Yeah.
Nobody cares.
Yeah, no one's going to... No.
Firefox users are watching porn? Of course they are. They're a bunch of hairy neckbeards.
Yeah, it... Well, there was something... I don't know how many people saw this, but a few years ago, Robert Scoble was interviewing John Dvorak, and he asked him about, you know, why do you get, you know, getting people so angry and getting links? And Dvorak decided to be honest about it, and I admire him for this. He said, look, here's the deal. I pretty much get paid based on hit counts. That's my value to whoever I'm writing for. So every so often, when I see my hit counts starting to go down, I have a simple formula. I write something disparaging about either Linux or the Mac. My hit counts then go way up. And it doesn't matter if it's true, I don't care. I just have to write something that's gonna piss people off, and then my hit counts go up. And what impressed me was, for once, he was being honest about it. You know, it was like, this is not, he doesn't believe any of this. This is just, I need me some hit counts. And I'm pretty sure Matt Hamblin knows that, you know, this is a generic problem faced by IT long before the iPad, and it'll exist long after the iPad. But by putting the word iPad in there, hey, hit counts go up, woohoo, more money.
Link bait.
Yeah. Oh.
Apple. So are we ready to move on to our next piece?
Yes.
Okay. Apple iTunes and the home insurance blame game. How many of you have your digital files insured?
Good luck trying to do
it. Didn't you know that this is a huge problem? Okay, how many of you actually maintain, like, backups of your stuff?
Good on you.
You appear to have solved this problem.
Johnny Evans, my dear friend, Johnny Evans, who writes a column called Appleholic over at Computer World, making the list twice this week, which actually is not completely out of character for Computer World at all.
No.
Explains to us that you should check your digital music to find out if it's insured, as many insurers don't offer coverage for your digital music collections within their standard policy. And Apple won't help you get your music back if it gets lost or stolen, even though it could.
Yeah, translation, if your house burns down and your $12,000 iTunes collection burns down with it and you don't have backups, if you go to your homeowner's insurance and say, I need $12,000 extra to get all my music back, they're going to kind of look at you like you are a little mentally disabled.
Yeah.
Well, now, here's the thing. The key phrase here, the key phrase in what he just said was, if you don't have backups.
Yeah.
The reason why this made the list is because Johnny Evans gets about two-thirds of the way through his article before he bothers to mention the importance of actually making a backup.
Yeah, and exactly. It takes forever to get to the point. And it's just link baiting. It's making this an Apple, an iTunes problem, when the story here is, if you got digital files, back them up or bad things will happen to them and your insurance will not cover them. That's a legitimate story, but spending two-thirds of the article babbling about the iTunes market and how much money goes through iTunes and how Apple could fix this if they wanted to before you get to the simple fact of the matter, back your stuff up, is just idiotic.
Yes, many legitimate music download sites will let you re-download music in the event of accidental or criminal loss of your data. Apple iTunes service does not.
Yeah.
Right,
Draconian Apple.
Because Apple makes the critical error in Johnny Evans' judgment of assuming that you're intelligent people who are smart enough to know that you should back up all of your crucial data, preferably in more than one place. Preferably rotating it off-site if it's that damn important to you.
If only Apple made an easy way to back up data on your hard drive.
Some sort of
machine that travels through time.
Yeah, like you could go back in time and retrieve your precious data.
Some sort of capsule.
Yes.
The LHG Wellsulator. I don't.
Yeah. Yeah.
Exactly right. You know, again, making a mountain out of a molehill, conflating two different problems. You know, does your home insurance policy cover digital stuff? Okay, probably not. I'm not aware of anybody who's does. Do you know offhand if your home insurance policy covers digital?
Have you asked? Has it even occurred to anyone?
Has it even occurred to ask if you should add a rider to your home insurance policy to cover digital data loss? You, sir, are the smartest man in this whole damn place.
Yes, everybody give him a round of applause.
Everybody, give him a round of applause.
Wait, what did they say? Yeah, so he asked and they said
50 bucks. $50 how often? $50 for $25,000.
Good deal.
Yearly.
That's
yeah, so $50 gets you $25,000 annually. Hey, listen, if it's important to you folks.
Yeah.
So back up your receipts.
Yeah, yeah.
So you can print out all of your receipts and then lose them in the fire.
Yeah. Yeah. Which of
again, backup often, and preferably keep a backup somewhere offsite if it's that important to you. I mean, listen, you know, we've all been, you know, in school or somewhere else at some point in our life where we were writing an important paper or doing something else important or, you know, making our tax returns and, you know, something went wrong with a file or the computer crashed and we lost it. That's sort of, you know, fate telling you you should have backups. But trying to blame Apple for not being able to let you download all of your music again is just barking up the wrong damn tree.
Yeah, just a tish. But, you know, again, you need links. You're right about Apple.
Links, precious links.
Traffic, precious headcounts. Google Analytics loves me. So the last one on the list.
Peter?
Our coup de gras this week.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. How many of you read Gawker? Gawker sites.
Shame
on
you.
How many of you read ValleyWag? The hell is wrong with you three?
Wait, how many of you read it because you can't get the weekly world news anymore, and so you miss out on all the awesome old school headlines like Woman Can Hear With Her Breasts and Bat Boy Attacks 3?
What's that?
Okay, so you have to for your work.
In their awkward, socially unacceptable, syphilitic, pustulant manner on your company.
Damn, that sucks, man.
Poor, poor bastard. I'm sorry for you.
Yeah. I mean, having to pay attention to those microcephalic morons is bad enough for us. Do you at least get paid to do that? Ooh.
So the coup de grace, the bullseye, the centerpiece of this week's show has to go out to Gawker's ValleyWag publication this past week. In particular, Ryan Tate, or as I like to call him, Ryan Taint, for his piece called "Meet Apple's New Boss, the Most Powerful Gay Man in Silicon Valley."
Yeah. Basically, the whole article is trying to out Tim Cook. Because, of course, whether or not Tim Cook is gay has so much bearing on his ability to do his job.
First of all, let me say that this entire article is set upon a false premise, and that is that with Steve Jobs taking medical leave, Tim Cook is now number one at Apple. But Tim Cook's title hasn't changed. He's still COO. So we know that Steve Jobs isn't gay. You know, he's married. He's got children. You know, he's ostensibly heterosexual.
Yeah, I mean, not that it matters, but that
right,
the evidence points in that direction.
So even if Steve Jobs was still there, based on this criterion, assuming that he is, Tim Cook would still have been the most powerful gay man in Silicon Valley.
Yeah. And the weird thing about this is this article goes on for almost two complete pages before even getting to the issue. And what's it based on? The section's called Romantic Interests. After Cook was profiled as a lifelong bachelor and intensely private elsewhere, because for those of you who don't know, a long time ago, lifelong bachelor is one of those weird little gay code words back when being gay could get you like arrested and stuff. We wondered if he might be gay. We've since heard from two well-placed sources, that this is indeed the case, and it sounds like Cook's sexual orientation has been the topic of at least some discussion within the company. Who here knows has dealt with Apple as a company like more than just going to the company store to buy a t-shirt? Okay, for those of you who don't know, someone at Apple being gay is about as earth-shattering as it being Tuesday, right after Monday, but before Wednesday.
No, I mean, and the issue with this story, you want to profile Tim Cook, fine. I mean, the man is important to Apple's well-being. You know, he's running the shop while Steve's off doing whatever he's doing. But his sexuality has no bearing on that. That's tabloid. That
this entire damn piece is tabloid from start to finish. They're talking about his affection for the Auburn Tigers football team and the fact that he keeps a Bob Dylan picture in his office. This is ripped straight out of the society pages of some, you know, dumpy newspaper.
Well, yeah. That's Gawker, but...
Yeah, I mean, and just in case they haven't gone sleazy enough, they talk about relationships. If Cook is in a long-term partnership, he's kept it well hidden. Given his brutal work schedule, though, it's hard to imagine how he'd find time. Still, he's got enough experience to have developed some preferences. Our tech executive source claims Cook is into Asian guys.
So, you know, George Takei, if you're out there...
Oh, my.
Oh, my.
Sounds too low. I've got the Total Douchebag by George Takei clip. Total douchebag. I can do it almost as well. Maybe I'm gay. you know, and they include his darkest moment. Cook was misdiagnosed with multiple sclerosis in 1996, an experience he later said made him see the world in a different way. He now helps raise money for the disease. Again, well, it's admirable that he does that. Who cares? The New York Times did a good profile of Tim Cook.
By comparison, actually, the New York Times did do a very good, you know, and it was just sort of, if you're curious about this guy who you've been hearing about, who you saw at the Verizon iPhone announcement, this is him.
Yeah.
You know, it was informative. It was informational about Cook's role within the company and his background. It had nothing to do with this prurient crap that Ryan Tate focuses his attention on.
Yeah. I mean, if you read it, it went into details about how, you know, Cook became an expertise in supply chain issues and how he helped Apple go from 60-day inventories down to just-in-time manufacturing, consolidated all their manufacturing costs, and, you know, the kind of stuff a COO is supposed to do, which is what you would theoretically care about when he's going to be taking an enhanced leadership position within the company because Steve Jobs is stepping back for medical reasons. You know, but that... You know, why would Gawker care about that kind of stuff when they can speculate about who he's sleeping with?
The part I love the best about this story, though, is the PDF that we captured of this article includes, you know, one of those situations where SEO just kind of makes you laugh. The text ads from Google, the first one is, meet gay men near you.
No, even better. Meet gay men near your eHarmony.
And by the way, Cook apparently cashed out about $169 million in Apple stock, so I don't know about you two guys. I'm totally willing to be gay for pay.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, we're talking about real money here.
Absolutely.
Sure. My wife would understand.
Mine would encourage it.
Yeah. You know, mine would be like, where's my house in Key West?
Man.
Yeah.
By the way, signature look. Ooh, let's find out his signature look. Cook serves on Nike's board, which is why you'll see him sporting Nike shoes under his jeans around the Apple office.
I would just
love to see Cook and Jobs get into a knife fight over their shoes. Kind of like the two guys in the Beat It video from Michael Jackson. You know, New Balance and Nike. That would be awesome.
They tie their wrists together and then start knifing each other.
Down, down, down.
Woo! That would be the list.
That would be the list.
That's the list for this week.
Anyway, this is a small sample of what you can hear each and every week on Angry Mac Bastards. What?
TV.
The TV.
Oh, you bought one.
I did my $30 business with them. That's about as much as they're going to get from me, Jeff. Thank you very much.
Let's put it, you don't have to say anything. The words TV hat, I think, pretty much.
That, by the way, okay, I will say this. All right, so, yeah, at the show this week, absolutely the nerdiest, stupidest thing at the show, and I can say this because I spent $30 on one, is the TV hat. Have you guys seen the TV hat?
It's probably pretty much exactly what you think it is.
That's a hat shaped like a TV.
Awesome.
It's if you haven't had random people coming up and just beating the hell out of you, wear this.
You know,
we'll fix
the TV hat, Darby, the TV hat, I love it because, you know, it's if you haven't seen it, go over there and check it out. you know, the guy's selling them and he's real pushy, which is why I bought one. Because I'll do anything on a dare. Eat a bug? Yeah, sure. All right, great. You know, okay, put that in your mouth, but don't chew on it and don't swallow. Yeah, right. So anyway, it's this, you know, baseball cap with a huge duck bill that's got the privacy screen that drops down on three sides of it, and then it's got a little pocket at the end of it covered with plastic where you insert your iPhone or your iPod Touch, and then a pair of magnifying lenses that drop down from the duck bill to magnify, so you get the big screen experience without actually having to hold the iPod Touch up to your screen. I can't wait to use this on the flight back. So,
well, and there's a reason that this is the copy here that I've got.
I'm going to have some snuff porn that I'm going to be watching on that thing.
The flight attendants are going to just start punching you at random.
From hilarious wild romps to intimate situations, TV Hack gives you the privacy you need to view adult content. No more will you have to shield your laptop from annoying glances or curious bystanders. Enjoy your R or X-rated films. Watch Vacation, Lady Chatterley's Lover, or your favorite adult movies on the plane, at the beach, or anywhere your heart desires.
How about driving down the 101?
Yeah.
Why not?
Who here remembers WKRP in Cincinnati?
What's that?
I was saying, because you know what this reminds me of was the radio ads for macho wigs on WKRP. In the wind, shh. In the rain, shh. Or with that special someone.
What I really want to be doing is I want to use the TV hat driving through San Francisco using like an augmented reality sat nav, you know, GPS app. That'd be great. I'm at the corner of Post and oh my God!
Sorry, lady. But yeah, so if they have one sale, it was him.
This copy actually has a guy. He's apparently not driving, but he is in a car, seat belted in a suit and some sort of travel mug, watching
porn. Get
the hell
out of here!
I'm not
joking.
My
God, he is.
It is. It's an executive watching porn. His next prison.
I love the guy sitting. Kudos for this ad copy.
The other photo is this guy in bed. You know, his wife's reading. He's watching, I guess, porn on his TV hat right next to his wife.
Holy crap! Wow.
What I want from the picture of the guy who's camping is the bear coming up behind him.
That'd be
oh,
awesome.
Wait, sorry, you're watching your TV hat. I'll come back later.
Yeah, this guy's got to be in the back. Yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the best part on the ad, it has the as seen on TV. So.
But it makes you kind of look like the Elephant Man, if you remember that movie. You know, you've got this sort of black, you know, hood of shame over your face. Anyway, thank you very much for sitting with us. It's 6 o'clock. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here.
Indeed. Thanks.
Later.
We've enjoyed it. Hopefully you guys have too.
Thank you very much.